Hello, everyone. I'm Marc Schuckit from the University of California, San Diego. And I am going to share with you today some research that I have been doing pretty much since the NIAAA was the NIAAA. And in fact, some of what I'll talk about actually began with the precursor of the NIAAA. So pretty much this is an exposition on how I grew up with the NIAAA and how grateful I am for all of the help that I've received over the years. I'm going to emphasize two prospective studies that I've been involved with. One that began in 1978 and is called the San Diego Prospective Study, and the other, the Collaborative Study on Genetics of Alcoholism. And I will be bringing in some data from a few additional studies. But it's important to note this is a rapid overview, almost a bird's eye view of the work that I've been able to do with wonderful collaborators and with the help and support of the National Institute on Alcoholism and Alcohol Abuse. My work actually began as part of a study when I was a medical student, and this study was funded by the precursor of the NIAAA, with Jack Mendelsohn. And Jack became a mentor and a very dear friend over the years. And my work continued as I had the opportunity of working with Enoch Gordas, as well as George Kub. And George had been a hero of mine for many years. He was doing work right down the street from us at a very close institute near University of California, San Diego. And he continues to be an important part of the work that I do. And especially want to pay tribute to TK Lee, who I met through the literature, worked with in the Collaborative Study on Genetics of Alcoholism. And of the many wonderful things about TK that I remember, it's this smile that just absolutely twinkles. My work, therefore, is a tribute to these leaders who have impacted so much on my life, as well as the awesome staff that I've had a chance to interact with over the years, especially in recent years, Antonio Naranjo, as well as John Matochik. What I'm going to be presenting is actually 50 years of work, and it is based primarily on the San Diego Prospective Study. So we can begin by just giving you a brief overview. This was a study that began in 1978 with 453 drinking, but not alcohol use disorder, not abuse or dependent, male students about age 20 or 21. As the study progressed, and as we went into a follow-up phase of the original studies that began in 78, we were fortunate enough to be able to bring in the wives as well as children, both sons and daughters of our original subjects. Everything adds up now to about 1,600 people. And over the years, we've been able to study both genes and environment. And because these subjects have been so good to us, even at 35-year follow-up, and that follow-up was basically ongoing now, we still have 90% of the original probands with us. So some of the data I'm going to present will be background on what we've done, as well as the follow-up as it's been done with the probands, who are now about age 55. And the probands are, of course, the individuals who founded, I should say, the families that we've been following over the years and then expanded into, and their children. And the children that will come up in some of the slides today are an average age of 28. And we're talking about children who have had experience with alcohol. The study basically falls into a series of steps. And those steps, again, are the basis of this presentation. In 1978, we had a hypothesis that in addition to other very important characteristics, such as impulsivity as well as family histories and personal histories of psychiatric disorders, we felt that the way that an individual responds to alcohol would be a very important part of a prediction of alcohol. So we were looking at the how the person responds to alcohol or a low level of response per drink. And indeed, that first section of the study demonstrated that the low level of response per drink in these quite young, not alcohol use or disordered, not binge drinkers, but people who had experience with alcohol, and how that related, the low response related to a risk factor for alcoholism, the family history. Then beginning in 1988, we had completed our acquisition of the 453 individual subjects. And now we did our first follow-up. And at that first follow-up, due to good circumstances and a bit of stubbornness, we were able to locate 100% of the 453, and all but three agreed to the 10-year follow-up. That section of what I'll talk about today is to address the question of whether the low level of response, which I'll explain more about in a bit, the low level of response predicts heavy drinking and alcohol outcomes, which to our good fortune, indeed it did. Then what we're going to do is look at 1993 to the present, where we are searching for genes, all with very, very skilled collaborators, as well as environmental characteristics that impact, and some of them mediate, how the low response to alcohol in the original subjects or probands and their drinking offspring, how those mediators work and those genes work. And I'm gonna put a special emphasis at the close of this talk today on a group of studies we've done in the last 5 years, especially with work across generations. So let's look now first at the background for this series of studies, as basically we looked at things in 1978. And again, the abbreviation SDPS is San Diego Prospective Study, the base study that I'll be referring to today. As I started to get into this kind of work in the mid-60s in medical school, and then as a resident, and then as a faculty member in the 70s, it became pretty obvious that there were strong genetic impacts on alcoholism, but that alcoholism, or better said, alcohol use disorders, are indeed very heterogeneous, responding to both genes and environment, as well as their interaction. So the search then turned to multiple characteristics, which is going to be the next slide, that are impacting on the alcohol use disorder, heavy drinking and alcohol problems. And each of those characteristics that people have looked at over the years are likely to also relate to both genes and environment, roughly 50-50, genes and environment, although the specific study I was referring to here was 60-40 genes holding slight sway. What were those predisposing risk factors? Well, alcohol metabolizing enzymes impacting on how a person responds to alcohol were discovered in at least the 1960s. And of course, those enzymes are genetically influenced. And as I would put an additional study together, I needed to do the best I could to control for something that by the mid-1970s was, to my impression, already well established. The next characteristic that I considered in the mid-70s is whether a person makes decisions without thinking of the consequences, and he or she is on the extreme of that. Higher levels of impulsivity, and probably going back to the 1930s, there were studies that higher levels of impulsivity is related to problems with both alcohol and drugs. Then psychiatric disorders, especially as George Kube refers to the dark side of substance use disorders. Those psychiatric disorders, as well as others, also impact on the risk for alcohol use disorder. But I was again fortunate enough to have good advice to try to focus on something that was a bit different, the low sensitivity to alcohol, which is again basically going to be described for you on the next series of slides. Here, by way of background, are some statements, and this developed over the years, and they demonstrate why we hypothesized that the low sensitivity to alcohol would be one of many characteristics, including high sensitivity in some individuals, that is more levels of excitement when drinking, as well as cardiac changes with alcohol, etc. But the low sensitivity by itself would help explain why, when especially young people begin their drinking patterns, they are drinking for effects like intoxication. And if it takes more alcohol to have those effects, they're going to drink more per occasion. And then that will also relate to associating with heavier peer drinkers, developing expectancies that the only time they can have a really good time is when they drink a lot, using alcohol to cope with stress and other characteristics. That, in a nutshell, is the rationale for the low sensitivity to alcohol and its relationship to alcohol problems. When we began the study in 1975, we did the pilot study, but in 1978, for the data that you'll be seeing me review today, when we began this study, we selected people who were at high risk for alcohol use disorders. In this example, they have an alcohol use disorder parent, and people who are at low risk for alcohol use disorder, individuals who are family history negative. And we matched them on things that would be likely to impact on their reaction to alcohol, as well as match them on things that might impact on their blood alcohol level over time in an oral alcohol challenge. Across the bottom of the slide, you see the 220 minutes of the usual challenge. On the left side, you see the blood alcohol, or it could be breath alcohol measure. And you'll notice that in this group, once you get to about 15 or 20 pairs of people matched on percent body water, usual drinking, smoking, and usual cannabis use, you can end up with groups that after an oral alcohol challenge are basically identical in their blood alcohol level over time, but differ dramatically as a group, not every individual, on the intensity of response to alcohol, the green line, for individuals who have a positive family history. And among the effects, which in this cartoon are listed on the side of the slide, are subjective feelings of intoxication overall lower in these young drinkers with family histories, body sway, which is a motor performance test, several EEG measures, and hormones, including the changes with alcohol, with prolactin, cortisol, and ACTH. So when we began the work, all of our studies were basically based on the level of response to alcohol as measured by an alcohol challenge. Now, most but not all studies have replicated this work if they select and match subjects the way we're talking about. But there's variability, of course, and some studies don't show this, but this is the usual pattern. Now we face a problem. We have something running in families, this low response at a given blood alcohol level, usually about 0.06 at the height of the blood alcohol curve. And and this characteristic is not only familial, but potentially, as you'll show in another slide, related to serious alcohol problems and serious heavy drinking in the future. But it takes almost a whole day to do these alcohol challenges and then wait around till people's blood alcohol level are basically zero. And anyway, because it takes so long and there are so few individuals that you can measure, and you need thousands often for the genetic analyses, we developed a second measure. And the second measure is asking an individual to think back, let's take that first data column, to think back to the first 5 or 10 times they had alcohol on their own and tell us the number of standard drinks when they thought way back to them, the number of standard drinks that were required to feel any effect at all, to feel dizzy or to slur speech. If they got to the point where they were stumbling, how many drinks did that take? Or when they fell asleep when they didn't want to. That is passing out with alcohol. Now here, of course, you must realize that the more drinks it takes for effects, the lower effect per drink, or the lower response an individual is likely to show in an alcohol challenge. Two measures here I want you to pay attention to. One measure is first 5 to 10 times, which we think comes close to measuring sensitivity as opposed to acquired tolerance. And then the two other measures, recent 3 months and period heaviest drinking, help us to add to the sensitivity the effects of the development of tolerance over time. So those are our measures. And why do I think that the higher number of drinks required for effects or lower level of response per drink is likely to be sensitivity rather than acquired tolerance? This is data I was fortunate enough to be able to join in on from the Avon Longitudinal Study of Parents and Children, which in recent years has been supported by the National Alcohol Institute. And these were about 300 kids out of about 3,000 who had exposure to alcohol enough to fill out this SRE. And again, the higher the number of drinks on the SRE, the lower the intensity of response if you were to test them with alcohol. And if we looked at those 300 or so at age 12, the amount they drank per occasion correlated at almost 0.5 with their SRE score. And problems as well, but not as strong. Alcohol frequency didn't correlate very much at all. But most of these kids had consumed alcohol, had periods of drinking alcohol, evenings of drinking alcohol, less than 5 times. So this could be acute tolerance as well as sensitivity, but it is likely that when measured, at least for the first 5 to 10 times that a person drank, that it is at least touching on sensitivity. So that's the 1978 to 1988 getting this was the information on whether the level of response related to risk factors. Others, such as Cindy Ehlers, have looked in Native Americans, and Susan Luzak as well. And others have looked at groups with low response to alcohol, such as Sarah Peterson, as she's looking at African Americans, and Maristela Montero, as she did a study that related to Jews, who are each the African Americans and Jews were a little more sensitive to alcohol, and those groups have a lesser chance of developing alcohol problems. So 1988, we start following people up. First follow-up from the San Diego prospective study had 100% of the subjects. And what we found, and I'll show you very briefly, is that the low level of response to alcohol predicts heavy drinking and alcohol use problems later in life, even if you control for drinking patterns at the time we originally tested them. And that information served as the basis for the last section that I'll have today, which will include information on if you know more about the environmental mediators of how the level of response to alcohol relates to alcohol outcomes of an adverse nature, then you might be able to put together a prevention study that actually helps you to identify people who are at high risk and help them to moderate their drinking proclivity toward problems. So the low level of response to alcohol has predicted future alcohol problems in the San Diego prospective study. We also had an NIAAA study, a separate study, where we were looking at fMRI or brain imaging characteristics associated with the low response to alcohol. We had separate funding from the National Alcohol Institute for a prevention study that I'm going to get to in the next section. And then we have studied the low sensitivity to alcohol using the self-report retrospective measure, the SRE, and a collaborative study on the genetics of alcoholism, the Avon longitudinal studies of parents and children near Bristol, England, and there are also data from cohorts in Australia and in Denmark. Remember, not all studies are going to show the same things that we have. Most studies, however, using the approaches similar to what it is that we have been using, support our findings. So low response, genetically influenced, or at least runs in families, and is characteristic of a variety of risk factors related to alcohol, and it predicts heavy drinking. Now let's turn to the period from 1993 to the present, and the asterisk includes information that has been published since 2016, so within the last 5 years or so. And in this period, we have searched for genes related to the level of response to alcohol, environmental characteristics related to the level of response to alcohol, and as you'll see, we've been able to look at those in two generations of the San Diego Prospective Study. We began, remember, the San Diego Prospective Study in 1978. They were 20-ish years old. These subjects are now an average of about 55 years old. And of course, they were likely to have children. And the children entered our study, both the sons and daughters. And when the kids became 18, so that they were likely to be in an initiation to alcohol period or soon thereafter, we were able to study them as well. So there are measures we have across both generations. All this study does is says, yes, with the help of people like Dongbing Lai from COGA and many others, we've been able to look for potential gene variations related to the low sensitivity to alcohol. The strongest we knew were there before we even started our study, and we did our best to control for, and those were the alcohol metabolizing enzymes. Just briefly, our San Diego prospective study do not have Asian individuals that would be much more likely to have the ALDH or aldehyde dehydrogenase major mutation, or the alcohol dehydrogenase, a 1B mutation. And we don't have Jews and Blacks who are also very likely to have those gene variations in alcohol metabolism. So as best we can, we are controlling for the effect of the alcohol metabolizing enzymes and looking for additional genes through additional characteristics that are likely to be contributing to the low response to alcohol. We're not going into that in very much detail. There's the article by Dongbing Lai, as well as an article that I did several years ago in Alcoholism Clinical and Experimental Research, reviewing the information on both the SRE and the alcohol challenge, demonstrating specific genes. But for this period, from 1993 on, I'm also emphasizing the environmental and attitudinal characteristics, and as they might mediate or partially mediate the low response to later heavy drinking. Well, we get our family history and our personal history from a structured interview called the Semi-Structured Assessment of the Genetics of Alcoholism that was developed by COGA. We measure impulsivity in the probands and their offspring by using a subset of the Karolinska pattern of tests, as well as the Barrett Impulsivity Scale. We look at expectations of the effects of alcohol in probands and original subjects and their offspring by using the alcohol expectancy scale. We use a drinking to cope scale. We use a part of the important people and activity scale focusing on peer drinking. And then we get our information on level of response to alcohol through alcohol challenges or through this self-report of the effects of alcohol retrospective measure. And let's take a look at a summary kind of cartoon of what it is we found in the San Diego prospective study, as well as in the collaborative study on genetics of alcoholism and the Avon longitudinal study of parents and children. Well, we've already shown you that the family history of alcoholism is related to many things, but it is also related to a low level of response to alcohol, at least as measured in 20-year-olds. And then the level of response to alcohol correlates with a bunch of things. If you have a low response per drink and are drinking more than most other people, then you tend to develop a peer group that drinks as heavily as you do. This use of heavy amounts of alcohol to give you the desired effect you want gives you an expectation that you need to drink a lot to have fun. And then while stress in our population did not have a major potential mediating effect of the role of the level of response to alcohol, straight line from that to heavy drinking and alcohol problems, it is using alcohol to cope rather than overall coping, overall stress levels that matter. And they're all connected. Well, not always the same in every subset, but this is the pattern we usually see. And if you add to this pattern, a structural equation model, a impulsivity measure, you see that the impulsivity measure also relates to family history, but only relates to level of response at about 0.10. And it finds its way through the structural equation model in a different pattern than does the low level of response to alcohol. But now for what for me is, again, the final section of this presentation, but it is the fun. It's the fun that I have had over the last 5 years with access to a data set that is longitudinal, males and females, and is ongoing across two generations. The first thing that I'm going to share with you are some recent studies that we've published on probands and offspring regarding a series of questions regarding the level of response to alcohol. And here we had something that was great fun. At the time of these analyses, there were 216 drinking offspring who filled out the SRE, and they were an average age of 28, which means that they were in the general range of the age at which we studied their original, their fathers, the probands from this study. But I'm going to pull data when the probands were about age 31, that's their 10-year follow-up, and take a look at how these data look across probands and drinking offspring. Well, as this part of the slide shows you, the age is similar, but not identical. And the fathers had a significant, but not overly significant, about the 0.05 level, had a higher number of drinks on the SRE, because we gathered those from the probands as well, than the offspring. They had a little lower level of response per drink, and their maximum drinks was a little bit higher. These findings are significant. It's not a huge amount higher, but it's higher. And then to my surprise, that the number of the 11 DSM-4, doesn't change if we look at DSM-5, the number of the DSM-4 criteria endorsed by these drinking probands, some of whom developed alcohol use disorders and some of who didn't, was about 1.6, and it was higher. The number of alcohol problems and the proportion of people in the offspring group who met criteria for an alcohol use disorder was much higher than in the original probands. Goes to show you what I know. I had predicted that in the offspring generation, that the impact of the level of response to alcohol, that is relationship to heavy drinking and alcohol problems, would begin to diminish. That we were just fortunate enough to find it in one generation, and it would kind of be there, but that it would diminish in its impact, and that turned out not to be true. We also could, across generations, look at this self-report measure, first 5 to 10 times, and the total that includes both potential sensitivity and development of tolerance, and we could look at this both in probands, which is correlations of 0.3-ish to 0.6-ish, and in spouses. Same direction and significant. And then we can, in addition to that, we can look at the sons and daughters, which is the relationship between SRE5 and SRET, SRE total, in maximum quantity of drinking was actually a good deal higher in the sons regarding the SRE5 anti, and was probably not significantly, but a little bit higher in the daughters. Again, consistent with we could test, and indeed, the low response was more closely related to alcohol use disorders in the next generation of that San Diego prospective study. Another thing that we could do is look at, well, does the level of response to alcohol as measured by this self-report measure, does it correlate across generations? And the probands SRE5 correlated with the son's SRE5 0.16 to 0.22, but did not correlate strongly with the daughter's problem. You can only look at level of response to alcohol within each sex, because women and men differ on how quickly they metabolize alcohol, as well as the blood alcohol level they're likely to get per drink. And the mothers correlate closer with their next generation, their daughters, than they do their sons. And again, one of the things that we never dreamed we would be able to go on to be able to test across generation. The brother pairs and sister pairs correlate very well. So we could correlate across generations about how SRE perform, as well as how the SRE scores themselves were across generations. The next to last of these examples, there'll be one more, of the kinds of things that you can do with a prospective study such as this, and the good fortune of having relatively consistent funding over time, is we had the opportunity in a separate grant that we got from the National Alcohol Institute, we were able to do a prevention study based on that structural equation model I showed you. We took 500 incoming freshmen, age 18, who were drinkers. We assessed their drinking at baseline, and they were made up equally of low responders and high responders, relatively insensitive and sensitive to alcohol. And that was after matching them on usual drinking, smoking, and marijuana use. The individuals in the study could become controls who got no education on alcohol, or they could be in one of two education groups. They watched 4 45-minute videos, some of which put a bigger emphasis on level of response, low level of response, some of which just gave a general overview, including level of response, but the information given was basically the same. I know because I put the four videotapes together for the level of response-based group and for the state of the art, meaning generic information. The information was there in both, but the emphasis was different. And then we followed these individuals up, and we continued to have 93% that did at least three of the four videos and at least five of the seven follow-up periods. And if we take a look, the data are more complicated, but if we take a look at over 55 weeks, that's at the bottom of your slide, and looked at the maximum quantity consumed, this is what happened to the control low responders. It was a pretty consistent increase over time. That big peak you see up there is a drinking festival at UCSD. It's not meant to be a drinking festival, but it's a week of celebration of something called the Sun God Festival. And boy, did those people start to peak on their maximum drinks during that period, which was where one of our measures was. So here's what happened over time to the people who were low responders, but got the general information. It was a significant decrease. And if the low responders were assigned to the group that really emphasized low response, their decreased maximum drink over time was the strongest of all. And for the high responders, they didn't need anything. For the high responders, which were the last three of the graph, of the figures that I put up in there at the bottom of the graph, they really didn't change much over time, but the low responders certainly did. Now, the very last of the things that I'm going to talk about is just very quickly. It is two papers that we've had very recently, one still in press and the other just recently published. The first was based on the fact that in our interviews, we review the number of alcohol problems and drinking pattern for anyone on the probands or drinking offspring. Then at the very end of that alcohol section, we, after they reported whatever they're reporting, we asked, how would you rate yourself in general? Are you an abstainer? Are you a light social drinker, a moderate social drinker, a problem drinker, an alcoholic? And 67% of the probands and 82% of those kids, after reporting enough problems to be diagnosed with an alcohol use disorder, either abuse or dependence, we stuck to DSM-IV for that distinction. 67% and 82% called themselves moderate social drinkers. And the only important thing here is this gives us the opportunity within two age groups to identify the DSM criteria that they were most likely to ignore. And even though they had alcohol problems, not admit to alcohol problems in those areas. And that was mostly related to whether they saw themselves as a non-alcohol use disorder individual or not. The other is that in my kind of studies, and in mine that began in 1978, we didn't go out and interview all the relatives to begin with. We took the offspring's report about their parents. And now we followed up the second generation and we got the first generation, the proband, over time. And almost 80% of the offspring did not know that their fathers were having any troubles with alcohol. And it was the characteristics of the fathers. Those stars are in information that ended up being a significant contributor to a regression analysis. That it was mostly in yellow, and especially the ones with stars, the characteristics of the father and not the characteristics of the offspring that predicted whether the kid did not know, or at least did not admit about knowing that his or her father was having alcohol problems. This allows one to be able to begin to interpret better the characteristics of individuals more likely to underreport in a family history study. By the way, our family history study turns out that, of course, among the people, when the kids say that the parent has an alcohol problem, almost 100% of the time the parent does. And that allows you to at least do an intensive study, such as we have, of a subset. Not everybody, but a subset of individuals who are being identified in a family history study. Well, I want to thank you for giving me the opportunity to share some of these data with you, and then express my sincere thanks to the National Alcohol Institute for all of the help, both directly funded as well as by impacts that the various people have had on the work that we're doing. And so the conclusions I'd like to leave you with is that this cross-generational study involving both males and females over time has some unique values to it. It's not the only way to do work, but it has some unique characteristics about it. These allow us to address questions that most other studies can't even begin to look at, because we have individuals in two successive generations of these families. These are challenging to carry out. Any longitudinal study is challenging to keep going, but we have been able to do that. These studies, such as leading to the prevention study, as well as the denial study, the denial analyses, and trying to understand more about who does and doesn't correctly identify alcohol use disorders in their prior generation, allowed us to address those complex issues. This study, again, could not be done without the help of my friends and colleagues at the NIAAA, as well as my friends and colleagues in the Collaborative Study on Genetics of Alcoholism and the Avon Longitudinal Study on Parents and Children. And if you had talked to me in 1978, I would have never dreamed that I would have had the opportunity to have such fun and hopefully add something useful to the literature, as I am still having and have had for 35 years.